Of isolation and the miracle of daybreak doesn't move you anymore. Connect the points and see the constellations as the night comes down on the reservoir.
To have them at this table for the first time, and some people on my staff are more than thrilled that they are here, because they're from Georgia, by the way. What is it going on down in Georgia with you and so many good musicians coming out of there? You know, there's something in the water down there.
I think it's the earth.
It is. It's
yeah.
The soil.
It's the soil. Yeah. Yeah.
Tell me your story. I mean, how you guys started together and how you have, in a sense, just continued with a loyal fan base. In addition to the Grammy Awards and all that other stuff.
Well, we Emily moved down from Connecticut when she was like 9, and we met in elementary school.
In Decatur.
Yeah, in Decatur, Georgia. We right. met in elementary school and sort of stayed kind of not just acquaintances for a while, and then we got into high school and got into the choir together and started to become friends and just started singing together and jamming.
Yeah.
And that from that point on, it was, you know, we went to separate colleges for a little while. She went to Tulane and I went to Vanderbilt, and then we both transferred back to Emory and in Atlanta, and just, you know, we just played. We played at bars, we played wherever we could get a gig.
Yeah.
Started writing our own
when
songs.
When did you know this was something you could do for long?
The first time I picked up a guitar. Absolutely. I mean, I came from a musical family, and Amy as well, and I started writing songs when I was about 9, and as soon as I held a guitar, I started writing stories about young women out on the streets who are trying to make a living playing guitar, and it was just kind of my path, you know?
Yeah.
Even though I studied to be an English teacher, at the same time, Amy and I were building a local following and a career, and so I just made the decision to go with music, but it's the most natural thing in the world.
Yeah. You know, we all know the story of Dave Matthews and how
awesome.
That band is awesome, but how they, you know, they got to start simply by letting people tape them as the Grateful Dead did and develop a strong fan base. Did you guys do some of the same thing? Because you have not had the benefit of great radio play.
You're right, we haven't. And we've always been open to taping. You know, it's kind of our policy. Whoever wants to come and tape the shows and share it with fans, not to sell it, but just to share it. I mean, we are a hootenanny band. We're a grassroots band. You talk about coming from the Georgia music community. It used to be we played Little Five Points Pub in Atlanta. We were like the house band. Our friends in the audience were musical. You know, one played flute, one was in a punk band, a whole motley crew. They used to come up and join us on stage, and we'd let people sing their own songs, and that's where we come from. So sharing music and the whole idea of sharing the experience, whether you're a fan or whether you're a musician, that's sort of our philosophy. So tape as many shows as you want. You know, we feel like it's a good thing.
Where did the name come from?
We were opening for a band in Atlanta. We got this gig, and we used to be called Sailors and Ray, and we just were like, we need to think of a band name. So we got the dictionary out and scanned it and saw the word indigo, and we're like, that sounds cool.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we were like, what, like 20 years old or something.
No, it's not the Indigo Girls, it's Indigo Girls.
No, I don't know. There's always an argument about it.
It doesn't matter.
I have no idea what it's supposed to be.
Now, the notion, the fact that you're both lesbians, but not together, so to speak, in a romantic way. Do people care about that? Do they know about it? Is it part of the appeal? Is it, does it have any impact at all on your life and your music?
Yeah, it does. I mean, it's, the impact has changed through time, how it impacts us. But, you know, in a way, I think that, you know, the queer community has been so supportive of us that, you know, for that, we get a lot of support from the queer community, and we appreciate that. It has held us back in many, many ways, you know, but I think it's held us back just on radio, you know, and in the media. And but I think sexism
is... They wouldn't come and write about your...
The way they write about us, you know, as much as anything else, you know,
it's more the personality and the lifestyle than it is the music. Is that it?
Sometimes, or it's our audience, or it's just derogatory remarks, or we can't get a break, sort of. But I think, you know, I think it's sexism as much as homophobia, honestly,
right.
Because we're two women that have images that are not as glamorous, you know, like I'm more masculine maybe, and it's not the kind of woman that you necessarily want to write about or that is necessarily easy to image. And so I think in that way it's been hard. But I think our political outspokenness has been the biggest hurdle.
On what issues?
On anything, you know.
Right.
It's like we're always, you know, I think we're doing a
whether
lot of activism.
Whether it's the environment or Iraq or whether it's...
Gay rights. Pro-choice or it's
anti-death penalty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's the fact that we are outspoken. I think it's, you know, women who are outspoken and sort of earnest for rock critics, that's a hard one. You know, they can't get their head around it. They can understand Rage Against the Machine, but they don't understand the Indigo Girls.
You both write songs, you know, and frequently when you have the combination that you have, someone does the music, someone does the lyrics, or frequently someone plays and the other is the vocalist and creates the music. You two both write songs, and both songs end up on the album. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's more to this, and help me understand what it is.
Well, there's a lot of reasons for it. Our sensibilities.
I realized I was explaining that. I wasn't explaining it very well, was I?
I mean, I think our greatest strength is our differences. Absolutely, we're a yin-yang experience. And
it's a yin-yang experience.
Yin-yang experience, no doubt. Amy writes her songs, she comes from her perspective, her sensibilities, her influences, and the same thing for me. And we also need that private, creative, artistic space. I mean, writing a song is a very vulnerable thing. You know, nine times out of ten.
Because what, you're trying to find the rawness of your own experience?
Exactly. You're putting out these lines that, you know, most of them are terrible at the beginning, or, you know, you're just working it, you're honing it. And for me, you know, a lot of times, unless you're doing a co-write, which I've done some of, but that's a completely different thing, where you just need that your own alone time and your vulnerability of the creative experience. But what Amy and I do together is arrange the songs. So once the songs are written and we know we have a project coming up, like a new CD,
right.
We get together at her house or my house, we start talking about the harmony lines. Our voices are in different parts of the musical spectrum, so that works out well. We talk about what instruments we want to play, how we're going to make it different, you know, not try to fall back on the same arrangement tricks. And then at that point, after arranging the song, that's when it really becomes an Indigo Girls song. And I've always felt like what Amy adds to my songs makes my songs better than they are on their own. So that's what we do.
Do you feel likewise or not?
Yeah. No, not at all. No, it's a, you know, that's why we're together still. I mean, that's why it's been 20 something years.
Why?
You know? Because the sum is greater than the parts, you know.
Yeah. Now, are you together? By this, I mean, you hang out together, or is this simply you come together musically, and then you both have your own distinct, separate lives, and don't see each other off stage?
Well, we see each other. I mean, I live like an hour from Atlanta in the country, and she lives in the city. So, you know, we live in different. We live different
lives. Are you a country
lives.
Girl and she's a city girl, or is it just?
Emily's a little bit of a country girl too. I think.
Country, yeah. Love the country as well. But
I see enough city on the road. I don't want to see it when I get home. You know.
So you live on a farm?
I live in the woods, actually.
Do you really?
Yeah.
Now, what does that mean? I live in the woods.
I live in the woods. I live on a river in the woods.
Yeah.
You know, in a house, and it's beautiful, land and animals all around and stuff. So.
Yeah. And how many months of the year are you on the road?
Well, when a record comes out, we'll tour for a year and a half. We do it like in 3 weeks, 3.5 week legs, and then we come home for a week. And so we do get breaks. But the touring schedule is about a year and a half sometimes. We go to Europe, been to Western Europe, we've been to Australia, and sometimes we do that, but mostly we focus on the U.S.
In your dreams, where would you want this to go that it hasn't been?
For me, the biggest thing, you know, well, I mean, we've gotten so much, but like, just in a business way, it would be really nice if something that we do that's more rock could actually get on rock radio, and it's so hard for a woman to get on rock radio these days. And that would be, that in my dream, that's an area that we've never been able to bust into, and I would love for that to be recognized, because we do a lot of rock stuff, you know, and it's part of what we do. But as far as just on a spiritual level or emotionally speaking, you know, it's fed me, you know.
It's a great ride.
Yeah, it's I mean, there's no, I couldn't ask for any more. In fact, it's enough. You know what I mean? It's enough. Yeah. It's like, I just want to play music, you know, and that's what I'm getting to do. And I could do that at any level. So I feel good about it.
And who's influenced you the most? Musically.
Because we have so many different influences. But for me, the most over time, over the large expanse of time, has probably been Neil Young. The
really?
Most, yeah.
Now, why?
Just as a longevity thing, you know, I've been influenced at different points by Patti Smith or The Clash or James Taylor, you know, or all these underground bands. But as far as on the long term, I've stuck with him since first grade, you know. And
isn't he doing a new tour that just started in London or something?
Yeah, I don't know.
He's always touring.
Yeah.
He's like.
Yeah. And you, same influences or?
Well, I love Neil Young.
Right.
He's right up there. But early on, I'd say Joni Mitchell, as far as directly inspirational as a song craftsperson.
Right.
And then as far as emotionally, spiritually, music, and all the elements, I'd have to say Stevie Wonder is probably the one that most speaks to my heart.
Because of the lyrics?
His lyrics and his supreme musicianship, the way his records are all different, the songs that last for years and years and years. And, you know, I like Black American music, and he's like the king of it to me in a way. He just brings all the elements together.
The following groups are represented on the packaging of your album. What do these groups mean to you? How do they get involved? Listen, MoveOn.org, National Gay and Lesbian Task Force, Rock the Vote, MTV, I think, independent, I'm not sure who Rock the Vote is. That may be not,
I think MTV has
started that.
It's
Independent Media Center, Amnesty International, Global Exchange, Honor the Earth, Women's Action for New Directions, Sweatshop Watch, National Abortion Rights Action League. You have a presidential candidate you're favoring in this? Upcoming elections, are Ralph Nader or John Kerry or George Bush?
On a personal level, I don't know who I'm going to, I mean, I'm not going to vote for Bush, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty obvious. But I want to beat Bush, so I'll do whatever it takes at this point. Sometimes I'm disappointed in Kerry. He's not radical enough for me. You know, that's my own feeling about it. You know, I get frustrated with that, you know. I liked Kucinich and I liked Sharpton a lot. So for me, you know, Kerry, it's hard in America because I think the Democrat candidate has to be more moderate than a lot of the radical people want him to
that
be.
That you would like him to be. You know? Share that. You guys share that.
I do share that. Yeah, I also liked Kucinich and Sharpton a lot, and Kerry's not radical enough for me, but I like Amy, I want Bush out of there. He's wreaked such havoc in so many arenas, so I'm going to do what it takes and vote for the person who could beat him.
Indigo Girls, All That We Let In. Thank you for joining us. See you next time.